I think I made it. Hey, y'all. Let's make sure I am actually live. See if y'all can hear me. Hey, y'all. Yep, you can hear me. Excellent. I'm so excited. Happy New Year to everyone. All right, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen really quickly. And so that you guys can see what I see. Let's see. I've got, if somebody can, let me just pull it up here on my phone really quickly, because I'm looking at one screen and I can't see the chat right now because I'm using a PowerPoint presentation. So if somebody can put in the chat that they can see my screen, I would greatly appreciate that. Maybe I can do it myself from my own phone.
Using a PowerPoint?
Yeah. Yep. I can see myself. I can see you guys. Thank you for joining me. If I'm looking over here, it's because I'm looking at my screen on my phone. I can see the chat. Welcome, Moni. Is it Moni J? Welcome. Is Samira? Hey, Samira from Ghana. Happy New Year. Karen. Hey, Karen. I haven't seen you in a while. Happy New Year to you, too. So I'm going to go ahead and get started because I have a lot to cover in a short period of time. And I don't want to take up too much of your time, but I want to be as thorough as possible. I'm glad you made it here with me today. I'm really grateful. I don't take it lightly that you have decided to spend your time with me today. God bless you all. How about you tell me where you're tuning in from? If you have a reproductive issue, what is it? And what are the major symptoms you're having? The reason I always ask these questions is because if you put them in the chat or if you're watching the replay and you write it in the comment section, that helps me to determine what videos I'm going to make going forward based on who, you know, what the most response is. And last week I did a video, I think it posted last week. It was about what your period should really look like because I was getting a lot of women who was saying, oh, I don't bleed that heavy. And when we really talked about it, they really do bleed heavy and they didn't understand that that's why they were feeling the way they were feeling. And they didn't understand that they were actually bleeding heavy because everybody bleeds heavy these days. We're not supposed to bleed, but when you're done with this, you can go back and watch that if you watch that my last video if you'd like to. Also share with me your symptoms. And I figured it was about time that I talked about what to eat, what not to eat, because it's been about a year since I did one of these videos. And I try to keep it up to date because some things change. As I talk to women on a regular basis, some things change, like maybe you can eat some things that maybe you shouldn't have eaten before. I said you shouldn't eat before and then vice versa. So let me go ahead and get started. Those of you who don't know me, my name is Chelsea Knutson. I am a certified holistic health coach, a certified life coach, and the creator of the 90-day Walk to Fibroid Freedom group coaching program, where I help women shrink fibroids naturally using food as medicine. I also have an emotional healing for womb wellness group coaching program, where I help women get free from the baggage that keeps them stuck in a perpetual cycle of womb issues. The links to my programs are down in the description box below if you would like to learn more about that. And my next emotional healing group starts on Sunday, January 9th. And the next fibroid program starts on Monday, January 10th. I thought I was going to have two fibroid programs, but this time I'm only going to have one. So if you're interested in joining, I've got a few spots left. Also, be sure to subscribe to this video, hit the notification bell so you never miss an episode. The information that I'm about to share with you is from my own personal experience and from coaching hundreds of women over the years. So you take this information and you do with it what you will. I am not a doctor. I'm not claiming to be a doctor. Don't want to be a doctor. But this information is what I have learned and how I have reversed all kinds of issues that I had going on in my body, not just from a reproductive perspective, but from all the way around. Like, I was a sick woman. But please add your questions, your comments to the comments section or the chat, so that at the end I will have the opportunity to answer some of those questions if we have time. So I'm going to move pretty quickly. All right. So before we can talk about what foods to eat to shrink fibroids naturally, we have to talk about the offending foods that cause inflammation in the body and cause fibroids to grow. Fibroids, PCOS, ovarian cysts, endometriosis, infertility, heavy bleeding, blocked tubes are all inflammatory conditions, if you didn't know. These offending foods all feed, the foods that I'm going to get ready to talk about, they all feed the viruses, the bacteria, the pathogens, the fungus, the yeast, the mold that cause reproductive issues to thrive in the body. And a lot of women will say to me, well, I cut this out or I cut that out, but I'm still not feeling well. It's because if you eat even some of these foods that cause the inflammatory conditions, you're not going to get well like you want to. So let's get into this list of foods. All right, first is sugar, white sugar, white processed sugar, cane sugar. It's a hormone disruptor. It's a toxic, acidic. It's inflammatory. Sugar is addictive. It's one of the reasons why we go back and forth when we're on this program. We can't seem to stop eating the junk. It's because most of us, unfortunately, whether we want to admit it or not, are addicted to sugar. So sugar is a big one. Beverages containing caffeine, not just coffee, but black tea, green tea, energy drinks, soda, and usually caffeine is in foods or products that are hormone disruptors. Caffeine is acidic. It causes inflammation in the body. The other big problem with caffeine is that it can block your body's ability to absorb iron from your food or your supplements. So if you know, if your doctor's got you on iron pills, or if you're drinking green smoothies and nothing's happening, but you're still ingesting caffeine, that could be the reason why you're not getting better. It's just one possibility. It's not usually the issue, but it can be. Saturated fat from animals, like any kind of animal, lard, cream, tallow, butter, cheese, ghee. Cheese is like the worst, but I'm going to talk about that in the future. I mean, here soon. These foods cause inflammation in the body. Of course, they're acid forming, mucus forming, the hormone disruptors, they're toxic, they're carcinogenic, and they cause fibroids to grow. Next is processed foods. You know, sometimes, you know, when we go to the store, especially health food stores, you see this thing on this package, on these packages on the right, where all these, you know, like Boca burgers, tofurkey, and it's vegan food. That stuff is junk. Like, just because it's vegan doesn't mean that it's healthy. But I'm also talking about cookies, cakes, chips, candies, breads, crackers, boxed mac and cheese, noodle dishes, flavored rices, biscuits, cereals. And women with fibroids have already a digestive system that is not in the best working order. If you did, you wouldn't have fibroids. And I teach more about that in my 90-day program and how all that works. But we got to get all this processed food out of our diet. We got to eat clean food the way God made it, as close to the way God made it as possible. And I'm going to get into that in a minute. So white foods like rice, flour, bread, pasta, cakes, cookies, rice cakes, sweets, candies. These white foods are hard on the digestive system. It keeps, you know, it backed up and congested. They don't have any nutrition in them, even though the box says they do. It doesn't, like, you can't get anything from this stuff. It's like glue in the belly. It's acid forming, mucus forming, disrupts your hormones, and causes fibroids to grow. Processed meats. Oh, these are really bad. Bologna, hot dogs, sausages, smoked meats, beef jerky, canned meat, bacon, ham, salami. I grew up on all this, so I know it tastes, all this stuff that I've been talking about tastes really good, but it's not good for the body. Also, any meat that has been cured or salted or smoked or dried or canned, it's inflammatory, acid forming, mucus forming, hormone disrupting, and causes fibroids to grow. And dairy products is probably your worst issue. This is, you know, dairy products are derived from a cow usually, or some type of animal that was meant, that milk was meant to feed a baby calf or baby goat so it could grow into a big cow or goat or whatever animal you're getting milk from. It's not designed for us to eat on a regular basis. That's why when we as people, humans, breastfeed babies, at a certain point we stop breastfeeding because they don't need it anymore. They needed that milk so that they could grow and get the vitamins and minerals that they needed so that they could grow into healthy children. And what happens is when we keep eating it, first of all, it's full of hormones, which causes fibroids to grow, but it also causes the mucus. It disrupts our hormones. It backs up our digestive tract, and it is extremely addicting. How many of you ever been like, oh, I can't give up cheese, like you got to have cheese? Some people don't have that problem, but I know that I talked to quite a bit of women who can't give up cheese, and I was one of them. All right, eggs. People think that eggs are so healthy. I'm sorry to break it to you, but they're not. Even the organic, cage-free, free-range, farm-raised eggs, they are estrogenic because they are really a chicken's menstrual cycle. That's really what an egg is. And it's filled with viruses, bacteria, pathogens that cause fibroids to grow. Eggs are not a healthful food. They are a chicken's menstrual cycle. I'm sorry to break it to you. Like I said in the beginning, I'm going to say some things that you might not like or agree with. Just take the information that you like, use it, and, you know, throw the rest away if you want. But I'm going to tell you, I have seen eggs keep people from healing because they don't want to stop eating them. Next is feedlot meats. And feedlot meats really are just the cheap pieces of meat that you find in the regular grocery store. They say never feed, not never given antibiotics, but they put chemicals and all kinds of things in the animal's food or feed to keep the animal from getting too sick so they can sell it. And they put this also put chemicals in the food so that the animal can grow as big as possible so that they can sell the animal at a bigger price tag. But these things are loaded with estrogen mimicking chemicals, toxic waste, they're acid forming, they cause inflammation in the body. And I'm not a meat eater. I'm a meat hater. I don't think that somebody needs to stay away from meat for the rest of their life. But when you are in the thick of this thing where you've got to, you're trying to heal, you may have to stay away from it for quite a bit of time until your body gets back into balance. And then if you choose to eat meat, you just don't eat it in the quantities that you ate it in the past. And whatever the meat is, you have to use common sense and buy the best quality of meat that your money can afford for you. But until then, just stay away from it because it's not helping you to heal the reproductive issues that you have. Okay, farm-raised fish. One of the biggest things people say to me is, Chelsea, I can eat fish, can't I? And the truth is the fish sometimes can be worse than eating the feedlot meat. You see this little farm they've got here? It's just as, these things are just as crowded and toxic, even more toxic than the feedlot that I just showed you in the last picture with the cows all stuffed in there. The fish are all stuck in here with all their feces and disease and, you know, just toxicity. These eating these is eating hormone disruptors and toxicity, and they cause fibroids to grow. And I could talk about this a lot, but I got a lot to get through, so I'm going to try to speed it up here. Things like soda, pasteurized juices, juice concentrates with sugar added. These juices normally come in plastic bottles you get in the grocery store, like Welch's, Hawaiian Punch, Kool-Aid, powder drink mixes, Gatorade. It's basically sugar water with preservatives, chemicals, artificial flavorings, and like high fructose corn syrup. And it's like a chemistry experiment. And no wonder our bodies don't feel good. No wonder we're bleeding. Our bodies are trying to detox all this crap it doesn't know what to do with. We just got to stop eating. And also, if you have a question, please put it in the chat box so I can go back and answer those questions when I'm done with the presentation. So thank you for that. Soy foods. There are some plant-based doctors that say that soy doesn't hurt women with reproductive issues. And I just happen to disagree. And I'm not a doctor and I don't have their education, but I just know that soy is not a good choice for women with fibroids. Maybe you can eat organic soy when you're well, but while you're trying to get well, I don't think so. Soy is a heavily sprayed crop. It's heavily genetically modified crop, and which that means chemicals. It's acid forming, mucus forming, and it causes fibroids to grow. All right, fried chicken. Don't cook food in oil. Y'all have heard me say that. Don't cook food in oil. You think because you put a little bit of oil in the pan and you put your little vegetables in there and you're sauteing them, that's not frying it. That's frying food. It is. It clogs up the body when you heat up oil. And keeps you from healing. It's acid forming, mucus forming, hormone disruptor, causes fibroids to grow. GMO foods, genetically modified foods, that's what that means. Some examples of GMO foods are like canola oil, corn or popcorn, soy, wheat, peas. Some tomatoes are GMO, so you have to be careful which tomatoes you buy in the store. Try to buy organic tomatoes if you can. And GMO foods are a chemistry experiment. It's poisonous because they use chemicals to change the genetic makeup of the food to make it intolerant to pests. So it lasts longer, so it grows bigger. And GMO foods just cause fibroids to grow, ladies. Corn. Let's just say no to corn for the last reason, just because of the last slide. And because it's highly GMO food, but also corn is hard on the digestive system. And if you were here at the beginning of our conversation here, women with fibroids, their digestive system is already a mess, whether they think it is or not. And I teach more about that in my 90-day program, but we need to eat foods that are not hard on the digestive tract. And corn is one of those foods. All right, fat-free foods. Just because it says it's fat-free on the package doesn't mean that it's good. Fat-free foods typically are just foods that are in a package that are loaded with sugar and chemicals to try to make it taste good, and it's not good for fibroids. Some people love to, like, when they get off sugar, they get on Equal, Sweet and Low, and Splenda. This is a chemical experiment. This is not good for anybody. These are cancer-causing chemicals. And they cause fibroids to grow. Not good to eat. Grains. Lots of people will say Chelsea. I can't have oatmeal. I don't think oatmeal is a horrible thing to eat. But when you have fibroids, grains are not good. They're not. None of them. Even the pasta, like the quinoa pasta and the red lentil pastas. And like when you start changing the structure of foods, when you eat it, especially when after you cook it, goes into your system, and it's like glue in your stomach. And it points right back to that thing I was talking to you about digestion. We have got to get our digestion and our guts healed up so that we can heal the fibroids, so we can heal the reproductive issue. And grains, things like rice, flour, oats, wheat, bread, pasta, that kind of stuff, is not going to help you with that. Technically, quinoa is good. And there's another grain or another product that people say is technically a seed. And you can use quinoa, but quinoa is the only one that I found that is like safe enough to eat. And some women even need to avoid quinoa. So I want you to be able to listen to your body whenever you are eating foods. You'll get to a place where you'll be able to listen to your body. And if your body is not responding well, then you can take that food out. I usually help people to work that out when they are going through my program, as they start to introduce these new foods to their bodies. Also, please add your comments or your questions to the comment section or the chat, and I'll be glad to answer them whenever I'm finished with the presentation. All right, so alcohol. Alcohol turns into sugar, which causes uterine fibroids to grow. There are hormone disruptors like alcohol. Just get off the alcohol if you've got a reproductive issue. It's an inflammatory condition. Fast food is the chemical experiment. Like, there's so much MSG and just chemicals in fast food to keep you coming back. Just stop eating it. It's not going to help you. Even if you've been drinking smoothies all week and eating your salads and having vegetables and all that stuff all week, and then you go on Friday and you just have your, you know, a little cheeseburger and fries from, you know, a fast food restaurant. Do you know when you do that, you're negating all the stuff you did all week? So we got to work on that if you're having that problem. Plastic bottles. Don't drink out of plastic bottles if you can help it. If you do, try to use BPA-free containers. BPA is a chemical that causes fibroids to grow. Some brands that I know of that are BPA-free are Smart Water, Essentia, and Fiji off of the top of my head. But we want to get off of the plastic. Plastic is not good. Drink out of glass if you can. Table salt is loaded with chemicals such as bleach. That's how they get it white. Just because it's labeled sea salt doesn't mean it's good salt. If you're going to use salt, use Himalayan salt, Celtic salt, something like that with some color in it. And if you can get off salt altogether, that is even better, even if it's the healthier salt. Because some people stay in food addiction because of salt. Gluten-free foods. You know, this food, the packaged food that says gluten-free on it. Gluten-free, like breads, crackers, cookies, etc., whatever. What you get when you eat gluten-free foods is potato starch, corn starch, this starch, that starch. You might as well eat the gluten. I mean, it's not stopping any, it's not changing the problem. So just don't eat that stuff. Potatoes. So I don't think potatoes are the devil. As a matter of fact, I think that if it's a choice between you going to McDonald's or going out to eat at a restaurant and putting some steamed potatoes in your plate along with your salad, I'd rather you do that than not eat the potatoes. But the thing about potatoes is they're healthy, but they're not a detox food because they're so heavy. And so I just suggest that you don't eat them if you are trying to get rid of all your symptoms and you're trying to shrink fibroids. But if you need to eat the potato once in a while to stay on track, then do it. That's my 2 cents on that. And here's another big key. If you're going to eat the potatoes, don't load them up with fat. Like, don't be putting oil on them, butter on them, you know, avocados on them. If you're going to eat them without fat. You know, put some seasonings on them, you know, however you season things, but don't like make them. That's the thing that makes potatoes bad. It's like what we put on them. So just kind of watch what you're doing with that. And I just want to speak on coffee just one more time. I know before I talked about caffeine drinks, but coffee in itself is acidic. When you're trying to heal, you want to eat foods that are more alkaline in the alkaline side of chemistry. And coffee is far from alkaline. It is acidic. Okay. Oils, all oils. Stop. Just throw the oil out. Like, you don't need to have oil, like, under any circumstances. If you need to cook something, use vegetable broth or water or coconut aminos in the pot to saute your food. I have many videos where I'm cooking. You guys do not see me pouring oil in the pan. Don't do that. It clogs up and congests the body. Some oils are very estrogenic, cause fibroids to grow, but really what they do is clog the body. So stop eating them if you're wanting to heal. So other plant foods to avoid, because some women, they cause symptoms to increase in their bodies. And some of those are cashews, chickpeas, or garbanzo beans. Now, I have found in the beginning of my journey, I could eat chickpeas or garbanzo beans and not garbanzo meat beans in small quantities. And not have a problem, but then I started running into a problem with them. Like, I would have a hormonal response, like my body would feel off and how like something would happen that make me feel like, something's not quite right. So then I tried eating garbanzo beans again. And what I have found in them, and some women have to avoid them altogether. So my suggestion is just not to eat them. But if you just have to once in a while, go ahead and eat them. But buy the cleanest garbanzo beans you can find. Meaning, if you can find dry organic garbanzo beans, make them yourself and, you know, go from there. Or you can sprout them. You don't even have to cook them. So there's that. And then sesame seeds, the white ones, have some women have a hormonal response to those. But some women can eat tahini that is raw tahini, like not buying the stuff that's roasted, because that right there will send you right into a hormonal response for most women. But if you buy the raw tahini, one brand that I really like, if you're going to try it just to see if it works for you, is called Artisana, and you can get it on Amazon. I don't have a link in the description box because I didn't realize I was going to talk about this today. But if you're going to try it, try the white tahini, the raw. Don't buy the cooked stuff, because the cooked stuff, it will send you over the top. Flax seeds, some women can get away with it, but I don't think it's a good option because they are so high in estrogen. But if you use them sparingly and listen to your body as you are using them. I think that is all I want to say about that. I'm almost finished, ladies. Okay. The other thing is high estrogen plant foods. Some plant foods have high estrogen levels. They're called phytoestrogens, and there's nothing wrong with phytoestrogens. Some of them, you know, cause women to have issues and some of them don't. And the ones I just talked about in the last slide are the ones that typically will cause people to have an estrogen response. But listen to your body. So one of the things I want to say, though, is you can look, if you go look up beans, all beans, they will have some estrogens in them because they are phytoestrogens. But when I eat beans, I don't eat like a ton of beans. Like, I limit it to like a half a cup of beans to a cup of beans. Don't even do it every day. Sometimes I don't eat beans at all. So I think you have to judge how your body is doing when you eat beans. You know, use beans as a condiment instead of, you know, eating a whole bowl of beans. And when you make bean soup, maybe put, you know, a cup or two of beans in a pot, but load the pot up with all kinds of other vegetables so that you can still have a large quantity of food without feeling like you're hungry, you know, because if you loaded that pot up with beans and that's all you were eating and you just had a little bit of vegetables, then you would be eating probably too many beans for your body based on what you're trying to do. But just keep that in mind. You know, you've got to listen to your body. Everybody is different. The other thing that people will ask me about is seeds and nuts and nut butters. You cannot eat those in large quantities. Some people will put them in their little snack bag and they're snacking on them all day. Like 1 to 2 ounces a day total for nuts or seeds. The other thing is if you're doing nut butters, like 1 to 2 tablespoons per day of nut butters, because they're too dense of foods for the detox process. And secondly, I think some of those things have too much estrogen in them. It'll cause you to have an estrogen response and you wonder why you're not getting well. It's because you're eating too many estrogen laden foods, even though they are healthy foods. Also, people think that they need nuts and seeds and beans and all that stuff to keep up their protein levels. And that is just a flat out lie. We don't need as much protein as we think we do. As a matter of fact, women who have fibroids are on protein overload, and we have to get the undigested proteins out of our digestive systems and out of our cells so that we can heal. So we have no need to worry about going into protein deficiency. As a matter of fact, you can poll any doctor and ask them how many cases have they found with protein deficiency. And it's almost none. Most of them will say none. They've never met anybody who has a protein deficiency. So you get plenty of protein in fruits and vegetables, believe it or not. Okay. So you may be saying to yourself now that you have taken everything away from me, Chelsea, what in the world am I supposed to eat? And to be honest with you, it's very simple. It's not necessarily easy, but it's very simple. You have to learn a new way to eat. You just do. Also, add your comments or questions to the chat box and to the comment section. If you're watching the replay, I'll be glad to answer those questions. And you have to commit yourself to learning a new way. It's not like you can just glaze through it, because it won't work for you. You have to really immerse yourself in learning a new way, or you won't succeed. So I just want to put that out there right there. You have to learn how to do this lifestyle. But you'll be drinking beautiful smoothies like these. You'll be drinking beautiful juices like this. You'll be eating beautiful salads like this one. Smoothie bowls. That one is gorgeous. It's absolutely gorgeous. And you'll need to learn a new way. You'll need to learn how to make these new things, and you'll need to learn how to make them taste good. And at first, when you first start eating this stuff, it's not going to taste good. Like, it won't. Like, so if for any reason you think that when you change your diet that it's going to taste good, probably not. If you're used to eating high fatty foods, heavy foods, all that stuff, it's not going to taste good. But if you take the food like it's medicine and you just keep on putting one foot in front of the other every single day, eventually you will start to crave the new food. Eventually you won't want the other food. Eventually you'll be like, why did I even eat that old food in the first place? Like, why did I even do that? And you won't, it'll be a thing of the past. Here are some of the foods that I eat. Like, this first picture is some oranges, and I have some green juice. And here's a soup with some quinoa. Here's a salad here. And here is a latte that I made from Capomo grounds. It's so good. It's going to be in my next, the recipe for this is going to be in my next ebook, which will be coming out soon. This is a stir fry. Here's some raspberry banana swirl ice cream. I got some coconut yogurt with some mango and blueberries. I got this big green salad, and I topped it with some peaches and blueberries. And all this might not even look appealing to you right now. You might be like, that is rabbit food. And yeah, it might seem like it based on what we have been used to eating. Yeah, but eventually this food will be very filling to you. And then here I got like this strawberry vinaigrette dressing, creamy vinaigrette dressing here. I got another soup, and here's some ingredients for juices. Here, got this fruit bowl with some yogurt on it, and I had some bananas and blood oranges. I mean, like, these are beautiful foods, and they're foods that are going to help your body to heal. Here's some other things I've got. This is right here. I had this for my birthday. So I had my grandchildren over, my children and grandchildren over, and I made a huge smoothie carafe with dragon fruit and bananas. And we all had smoothies, and they sang happy birthday to me, and it was wonderful. Could I have made a vegan cake, a healthy cake? Yeah, but I didn't want to that day. We had smoothies, and that thing tasted like bubblegum, the smoothie. But, and here, right here, this, like, this is a chocolate chip mint ice cream is so good right here. And my juices, and here's a salad dressing, and here's a stir fry. I mean, like, it's endless. There's so much that we can eat. And then I have provided you with resources. You can pull this information together by watching my YouTube channel, watching the videos, and learning as much as you can. I have playlists on my YouTube channel for what I eat in a day and recipes. There are how to shrink big fibroids, how to reverse anemia, how to stop your hair from, you know, falling out. There's everything you need is there. Also, I'm in the middle of getting my website revamped. I think it will be live at least in the next 3 weeks. I'm hoping in the next 3 weeks. So I'm going to have a whole new recipe section there, but there's recipes there. There'll be more resources there, but I have even 2 ebooks. Well, I have 1 ebook for 7-day meal plan. Some of you have that 7-day meal plan ebook with recipes. You have my juicing ebook and my volume 2 of the 7-day meal plan is going to be coming out really soon. I thought I was going to be able to have it this week, but it's not quite finished yet. But like, you can do whatever you have the desire to do. Also, go to my Instagram page at What Chelsea Eats. The recipes are there. Pictures of food are there. Like, you just have to apply yourself. Nobody is going to do it for you. I wish that I could do it for you, but I can't. I can't. If I could just do like that and zap you well and you wouldn't have to do anything, I would love to be able to do that, but you can't. You got to have some skin in the game, and you got to commit, and you got to change your behavior that got you in this position in the first place. And it's not an easy process. Sometimes we need help pulling it all together. If that's you, click the link below this video and apply to work with me. We can have a conversation to see if working together is a fit for for both of us. So you can get on my calendar this week. The next group starts on the 10th for the fibroid program. And then my emotional healing group starts on Sunday. But you don't even need to join my program. Like, you don't. You could. It will make things easier. You'll probably learn things that you won't learn off of my YouTube channel, and you'll get support that you never thought you would get for this journey ever. It's an amazing program, but you don't need it. Everything you need is at your fingertips. It's right there on my YouTube channel. But there is a sisterhood and camaraderie that comes from joining my program, but it's not necessary. I would love to have you if you want to join, but you don't need it. You don't need to, unless you need help. So I'm going to stop sharing, and I'm going to go ahead and look at some of these questions. Okay. Looks like I've got, okay, Latasha, welcome. Lady Tony, I can see you. Thank you, ladies. From Nigeria. Let's see. Diverticulitis and fibroids, postmenopausal, but still having chronic pain. So this is a good one, Moni. Thank you so much for actually saying something about this. You remember how throughout the presentation, I have said that women have their digestive tracts are a mess. Well, this is an example. She was diagnosed with diverticulitis, but there's so many women who have all kinds of digestive issues and they don't even know they have them. They might not have them diagnosed, or they're not diagnosable issues. They're just jammed up, just backed up, and they need to get it cleaned out. So thank you for sharing that, diverticulitis. And even people who have gone through menopause, they will still have issues with these fibroids. And not everybody is guaranteed to shrink fibroids just because they go through menopause. I did a video on that. I have women in their 60s and 70s that I'm helping right now who are wanting to shrink the fibroids. Growing. Also, these women, some women are having breakthrough bleeding in their 60s and 70s. Imagine that. I was just diagnosed with large fibroid on my left side and I'm dealing with extreme pain daily, will not let up. Aurelia Johnson, I think I'm saying your name right. If I'm not, I'm sorry. Do what I just taught in this video. Get rid of the offending foods and start eating the good foods that I teach about, and that pain will go away. You may need some additional help, but that's a good start. Happy New Year, Cam. Happy New Year, Charisse. Okay, from Virginia, dealing with a grapefruit-sized fibroid, heavy bleeding, leading to anemia, seeking to stop or shrink the fibers through menstrual diet rather than a hysterectomy. I don't blame you, Jennifer Records. Jennifer, take the offending foods out and add the healthy foods that I teach about, and you will start to feel better. And that anemia will reverse. The other thing too is the doctor's always telling you to come every couple months or every month to get your blood drawn when you have anemia. First of all, your body can't even keep up with replacing that blood that they're sucking out of your blood, out of your body. And then if you have anemia, you're bleeding too much when you have your cycle, you can't keep up with it. No wonder you're still anemic. Do you know what I mean? So I didn't reverse anemia until I stopped letting them take my blood every few months. I just stopped letting them take. Now, I'm not telling you what you should do, but we have got to take some responsibility with letting our body heal. And part of letting it heal is letting it do what it needs to do to replace the blood. Let's see, from Minnesota. Hi, Minnesota. Had an open myomectomy not even a year ago, and I had 12 fibroids, and my uterus was about 5 months pregnant. Anyways, fibroids returned already, but they're small. I hear that all the time. Change your lifestyle. You are not alone in that. Happy New Year, Chelsea Doris. My cycle was very irregular after the myomectomy. My hormones did not return to normal. Because this is why when you get surgery, things don't always change. It's because cutting it out doesn't solve the problem. You don't have a fibroid problem. You have another problem, which is toxicity. Toxicity in the body is why the fibroids grow. So when they cut it out, it doesn't take away the toxicity problem or the hormone problem or the stress problem or the dehydration problem or the, you know, let's go down the list problem that you have. It doesn't take all that away. So So my motto is don't cut it out, clean it out. So being that you got it cut out, let's start cleaning out your body. I need help stopping with the extreme pain due to fibroids. Yeah, the thing that's going to stop the pain is to stop eating the inflammatory foods. Inflammatory foods cause pain in the body. When you stop eating the inflammatory foods, that's when the pain will go away. I'm on my 15-minute break at work. We'll resume. Okay, welcome. Thank you for coming in. had a C-section uterine rupture 8 months ago. Ultrasound is showing small fibroids. I'm in severe pain right before my cycle begins. I'm so sorry to hear that. Tiff knows beta. Same thing though. We got to get rid of the inflammatory foods that's contributing to the pain. It's like inflammation goes to the place. The pain is inflammation trying to make that thing feel better, but it can't because we keep feeding it inflammatory foods. So when we get that inflammation out, it will start to feel better. Hey, Marilyn, how you doing? Alyssa Eggs, yes. A lot of people say, you must be out of your mind, Chelsea. I'm really not. Eggs are not good for fibroids. Hello, Queen. I'm following. Hey, Vernisha. Sorry if I've mispronounced your name. How about peanut butter and oatmeal? I don't eat peanut butter very often because you can't really find it raw and it's hard to find a good quality peanut butter. But if I do, it's only once in a while and I'd never eat oatmeal. It's a grain. Also, all of you, just download the foods to avoid list that is below this video. If you haven't downloaded that already, it's down below the video. Just click the link, download the foods to avoid list, and I'll send that to you. And then you can get everything that I just talked about on the offending foods list. Yes, red meat. Get it out of your diet. It's horrible for fibroids. What vitamins do you recommend? Alicia, thank you for asking that question. I never throw out vitamins because everybody is different, because what one person needs is not what everybody needs. What I do is when people join my program, I have them fill out a questionnaire and find out as much as I can about them. And then I make recommendations about herbs and supplements for them. And then they can make the choice as to whether or not they're going to do it or not. How to deal with cravings was doing good for a few weeks and then caved and ate almost a whole loaf of bread. Bread is my biggest weakness. Allison, you are not alone in that. One of the things that I know that helps with this is you've got to get all the offending foods off the list, that are on my list, all out of your diet, because those foods are addictive foods. So when you're continuously eating addictive foods, it's just a matter of time. You're going to go back to the other foods, right? Even if it's a small portion, a small amount, right? So some of you have heard me say, like a crack addict can't have just a little bit of crack. If you give them some crack, they're going to smoke all the crack and then they're going to want some more crack. That's, you know, any drug addict, right? And so as long as we keep letting little bits and pieces in, we're going to continue to eat and want that food. And so for me, I was an extreme food addict. Like it was bad. So I had to get all of that food out, stop eating it, not letting any of it in, not even a drop of it. And then my taste buds got to a point where I don't want to eat that food. And that's what will happen for you as well. I'm so sorry you're having that issue with the bread, Allison. What about red quinoa? Red quinoa is fine. Cauliflower rice is good. No lentil pasta. No, anything pasta related? Mm-mm. It might not hurt you the first time you eat it. The second time you eat it, I don't recommend keto foods at all. High fat foods are not good for detoxification. In my opinion, but that's also a loaded question. So I have other opinions and this is not the time or place for that, but I recommend eating a low fat, plant-based diet for healing. And if you can be completely raw, a complete raw foodist, that's going to get you your fastest results, but you don't have to be. But living a high raw plant-based, low fat plant-based diet is going to be the best for healing. And a raw food diet, some people will actually have to be, depending on their situation. Grits, no to grits. They've made these new nonstick pots and pans. They say they are healthy. Have you seen these? So it depends on what you're talking about, because I see them all the time. I find that I like 360 cookware. You guys, I have a video on my YouTube channel about 360 cookware. It's expensive cookware, but the thing is you can't go wrong with stainless steel. It's not going to leach chemicals into your stuff. If you watch the video on my channel, if you decide that you want to buy it, I have a discount code. It's WCE20, but it's expensive, but it's some darn good cookware. And if you buy it, you will not have to replace it unless you just want to look at new, beautiful cookware in 10 years. So, all right. Butter. I wouldn't use butter or ghee or any animal protein. No, none of that. The only fats that I would use are like avocado and fats that are in their whole form, like nuts or seeds. You can use coconut, not coconut oil, but coconut. Flax seeds make my hair shed, and I never knew why. I'm sorry to hear that. Turning in from Michigan, fibroids hospitalized regular severe anemia. That Danny, that's a sign that you've got to change your diet to get rid of the offending foods that keep causing the problems. I'm here. Massa, hi Massa. I'm glad you made it. What are some foods that will help maintain your weight with fibers? You don't want to drop a lot of weight if you're already slim. So Rosie, this is the misconception about that. Sometimes people are not, sometimes you have to lose a little bit of weight in order to get rid of the estrogen, the excess estrogen in your body, but you can build it back up. I have a video on my YouTube channel. You can go watch it. It's called something like How Not to Lose Too Much Weight, or Are You Losing Too Much Weight? If you just go search on my YouTube channel, you should be able to find it, and I give an explanation about that. But the key is most people just don't eat enough. You got to eat enough. Let's see. I agree. This is definitely helps. I'm glad it helps you. Appreciate it. This is true work here in motion. Supporting your platform is important. I learned so much in a matter of minutes. I'm so glad. Thank you, CPEM. Bless you. Are there many options for cooked foods? I love salads and smoothies just, but sometimes I want hot meal. Yes, absolutely. I have them on my YouTube channel. You can look at them. You can look at them on my Instagram page as well. You do need to eat, when you're trying to heal, you do need to eat mostly raw foods, but absolutely. I eat cooked foods and my clients eat cooked foods. Some of them have made choices to go 100% raw because that's where they are in their journey. But yeah, what do you do about the uncontrollable gas? So that's part of the healing process. Remember, I've been saying that the digestive tract is a mess. Well, that's part of the healing process. It will eventually go away. Just keep at it. Let's see. Karen, thank you. Breast tenderness is my biggest issue 2 weeks before my period. Also have a 52-day cycle with occasional 43. Don't know about fibroids. Yeah, that right there is a sign that you need to get rid of the offending foods, the foods that are on the foods to avoid list. Go ahead and download that list so you can get your cycle in order. Also, I have an endometriosis testimonial that I did a few weeks ago. You might want to look at if you have endometriosis pain as well. Chelsea Doris, you're so sweet. Oatmeal, no to oatmeal. And bananas, you can eat bananas. Saycon. Thank you for posting that link. Saycon talks. I love the cookware. I use it all the time, and it's just fabulous. And it has a special technology that keeps you from having to need nonstick. I just love it. Since you advise against oil, what are you using for stir fry and water? Water. I use water. I use vegetable juice. I use like carrot juice, tomato juice. Sometimes I use coconut aminos, which I don't use it very often because it's too salty for me, but you can use that, but mainly water. And then I use herbs and spices to season my food. Okay, I think I answered your question. I believe that stir fry will be most savory, enjoyable type of meal. Yeah, you can do that. And the key about stir fries is try not to cook your vegetables too much. Like keep a little crunch to them, you know? Like, so sometimes I'll put like carrots and celery in there. And then there might be tomatoes and zucchini, those things, and onions and garlic and stuff like that. And those things are softer, but the carrots and the celery are a little bit more crunchy, just so you have some texture in there as well. Okay, I think I answered that question. Thanks, Chelsea. This is working for me. I started to apply all you said back on December 15th, and today the pain is greatly reduced from fibroids and the weight is down. Yay! Congratulations, Julie. I'm so excited for you. Blessings to you. And Karen, I've been praying for you for a long time. I implore you to take heed of what I've just taught in this video, because the arthritis will be a thing of the past. As a matter of fact, I have clients that have had rheumatoid arthritis reversed. Yes, I said rheumatoid arthritis reversed. The pain gone, off medications. So I know what I'm talking about. Samira, no oil at all. Chelsea, thank you for your guidance. I lost weight and was bleeding lightly. Sadly, I've fallen off myself. I know my hormones are a mess along with my belly issues. Just get back on track. It'll turn around in no time. Is it Kalilia 55? Do you use an air fryer? Sometimes, not very often. Sometimes, but nothing's wrong with an air fryer at all. I am a bad food addict and cannot eat any of these things. It's a trigger. Are you familiar? Hey, Veronica, are you familiar with W. Kite Hill yogurt? You know, I saw it in the store, but I did not look at the ingredients, because whenever I do buy yogurt, I buy Kokio, because I found that Kokio is made from a young Thai coconut, and it doesn't have any other ingredients in it except for like whatever they're using to ferment it. And it's a plant-based product. So I've been using that one, but the next time I go to the store, I'll take a look at that one. Like using vegetable stock in place of oil for the stir fry. Yes. What do you think about the air fryer craze? My mother loves hers. Yeah. I was thinking maybe I could find a healthy way to do zucchini and onions. So personally, I don't use the air fryer very often. You can use an air fryer. It's going to make your vegetables taste nice. Just as long as you don't put oil on your food when you're putting it in the air fryer, you're good. But even more than the air fryer, if you're looking for a healing lifestyle, this is me personally, unless you just want to eat a bunch of cooked food, because what's going to happen is once you really commit to this way of life, you're not going to want to eat all that cooked food. You might want a cooked meal here and there, but you're not going to want it. I would personally do a dehydrator. That's what I would do over a cooked food, over air fryer, but that's me personally. And some air fryers have a dehydrator function, but they're not big enough to put as much as you need to in it in order for the air, for the dehydrator function to actually be worthwhile, in my opinion, unless you're just doing small quantities. I have a video on my channel talking about dehydrating food, but it doesn't hurt to have an air fryer. I have an air fryer. I have like a air fryer toaster oven thing. It's by Cuisinart. And then there's a Breville air fryer that everybody's talking about, but can't hurt. Let's see. How about cassava, pumpkin, plantain, green bananas? I mean, you can eat those things, but they're starchy. So you have to, you can't just eat a bunch of starchy food and expect a detox. Because starchy food slows down the detox. So I would limit starchy foods to about a cup a day. Hey, Monica. All right, ladies, this was a very vibrant live. I'm so grateful for each one of you. So I'm gonna go ahead and close now. Oh, it's been an hour. It went by so fast. So I just, you know, I speak life over you and blessings over you. And I pray that God would heal your body and that those of you who are struggling to get yourself on the right track, I pray that God would just come and help you to make the decision that you are going to take care of your health no matter what anybody's saying, anybody is doing, anybody is saying, you know, it doesn't matter. I just pray that, you know, healing would come because it's there for the taking. Jesus went to the cross so that we might be healed. And a lot of us are sick and we shouldn't be. So what's it going to be? Let us do our part and go after it with all of our hearts, with God in the center of it, and we cannot fail. All right, y'all. I love y'all. Thank you so much for joining me today.